key subjects, key topics in each particular chunk. And if you want to use that word section, we might be more appropriate. This morning, we're going to look at verses 3 through 14. And we're going to look primarily this morning at some words. Some words that are grossly misinterpreted by many people, I think. Some words and things in the book of Ephesians that people jump to conclusions and think it says something that it doesn't say. And so we'll find in the book of Ephesians that as we study it, there are things that you can read over and think something, if you don't study it, may be different than what it's actually saying. So one of the things we're going to be looking at and learning to do, I believe, is to be careful students of God's Word. Careful students of God's Word. And the Bible does tell us to study, doesn't it? To show thyself approved. It says to study to show thyself approved. And so we will be digging a little bit, and I try not to move too slow, because I'm prone to get hung up in certain things when I teach like this. I'm trying not to do that. But I don't want to rush either. I want us to take our time and learn. Now, before we get started out, I want to just impress one thought upon you. Look at your Bible or your devices, whatever you're using, and just kind of take in your mind here. Look at verses 3 through 14. Don't necessarily read them, but just look at that. That's a pretty good section of writing, isn't it? Verses 3 through 14. Actually, 3 through 14 would be what? 12 verses, wouldn't it? So there's 12 verses there. 12 verses, 3 through 14. And the reason I want to bring that to your attention is because we understand the Bible was written, the New Testament was written in Greek. That is one sentence in the Greek language. 3 through 14 in the actual Greek text is one sentence. Here we break it down into 12 verses. And where we run across difficulty with that is those of us who are used to the English Bible, read the English Bible, and me being one quite often, when I read the Bible, I look at a verse as a kind of a thought that stands alone. When in this case, there are 12 verses in one sentence. So each verse is a small part of this sentence. So when we're reading this passage, the reason I bring that up, because to interpret this passage and understand this passage, we have to understand this is one flowing thought. This is not 12 distinct separate thoughts, but this is one flowing thought. Now, I understand in our culture, in our society, the time we live, we have a hard time with thoughts that long, to be quite honest. I know it works sometimes. I have the privilege of at the job I do that anytime we have frustrated people, I'm the one who gets to deal with frustrated people. And so that's a blessing that I have. That's a gift I have. I get to deal with frustrated people. And the funny thing, when you're trying to communicate with frustrated people, guess how long a frustrated person's attention span is? Not very long, is it? You know, and I'll be sitting and talking to somebody, trying to explain the situation to them, and you know, I'll say like 3 or 4 words, and they'll interrupt me. Now, I have a way of handling that. I don't allow that. I just tell them very plainly, I say, you know, if we're going to communicate, that's fine. I'll sit here and give you my time. But communication means I talk and you listen, and you talk and I listen. Well, I didn't listen to you. I says, no, you listen to 3 words of a sentence. Let me give you a heads up. The thought I'm going to share with you is about 3 paragraphs long. So unless you can patiently sit there and listen to me for a few minutes, we can't have a conversation. And if they choose to listen, that's fine. If they don't, then the conversation is over. And I go on and do my next thing and tell them when you want to come back and communicate, we can. Now that's difficult for us in our time. We're used to things that happen fast. We want, you know, little 10-second infomercials. We want, you know, to break everything down to one quick thing. We want 20-minute sermons. I mean, we want everything broken down. And here we have in one Greek sentence something dealing greatly with the eternal purposes of God. Point is, it may take a minute to study one sentence this morning. Because in those 12 verses, is a lot dealing with the eternal purposes of God. And if we don't understand this one sentence, then we're going to probably misunderstand the book of Ephesians. If we don't understand this one sentence, there's a lot of things in our Christian life we're going to get wrong. We have to understand the eternal purposes of God and how in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. Now, one of the things that we've got to do is we've got to take a little bit of time this morning and understand one really small word in there. Who hath blessed us? Who hath blessed us? Who hath blessed us? Who hath blessed us? You see, one of the first things we got to determine, who's us? Because that's pretty important, isn't it? And I thought, a lot of times you might say, who's us? And people might say, well, that's us. But us is not a very good definition of us, is it? So if we just say us is us, we don't know any more than we did. And we have to understand, to interpret and understand the book of Ephesians, we have to understand who us is. Because Paul's mentioning something here. He's not saying you. He's not saying me. He's saying us. So the book of Ephesians here, the passage we're dealing with, is talking about a group of people. And we have to know who that group of people is. Because if we don't understand who that group of people is, then we're not going to understand the book of Ephesians. And matter of fact, that word us there is very dominant in the verses I just gave you. And first of all, verse 4 says, chosen us. Verse 5 says, predestinated us. Verse 6, made us accepted. Verse 7, we have redemption. Verse 8, abounded toward us. Verse 9, made known unto us. Verse 11, we have obtained an inheritance. Verse 12, we should be the promise of his glory. So it's very important, considering it addresses us and we so much, that we know who us and we is. Or else we don't even know. And again, this is stuff that when we study the Word of God, we can just fly right by, read right over it, and we just think of us and we. Who is that? We have to identify us and we. And a lot of times when we read the scriptures and we zoom past it, we don't understand sometimes the fine truth that we have to look at the scriptures. Now there's something that will give it away to us, what us is. Now we can look back to verse 1 and we can see what it's talking about there. It is talking about those who are Ephesus and who are faithful in Christ. But then goes on in those 14 verses and uses two more words that's very important in understanding who us is and who we are. And the thing that I always try to teach when I talk about studying the Bible is where the answer is. And I always get a kick out of people. I'll be teaching a Bible class or something. I'm sure I've done it here with you guys. I'll be your person. I'll ask a question. And I'll ask that question, and everybody starts brainstorming on what the answer is. And they'll give me every answer under the sun. This person give me an answer. 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 This give me an answer. Everybody begins to tell me what they think the answer to the question is. I just read the answer. It's in the verse. Like I always tell them, anytime I ask you a question, the answer's in the verse I just read. Why am I doing that? Because I'm trying to teach people to look for the answers to their questions in God's Word. And when we're trying to study God's Word, we have to look for the answers to the questions in His Word, not in our thinking. It doesn't matter what I think the answer is. It really doesn't matter what you think the answer is. What really matters is what God's Word says the answer is. That's what we're after today, isn't it? We're searching for the answers to some questions in God's Word, not what Pastor Mike thinks the answer is, not what somebody else might think the answer is, but what does God's Word say it is? God's Word will always explain itself. Like I always said, like in the book of Revelation, you get all that symbolism, they're like brainstorming, come up with what they think it is. Well, dig it out of the Word of God. It'll give you an interpretation of what the symbolism is. The answer's in the Word. I used to teach a Sunday school class years ago, and I used to get a kick out of them. No matter what question I asked them, they had three answers. Pray, read your Bible, and go to church. Those were the three answers. Any question I asked, what should you do about this situation? Pray, read your Bible, and go to church. Well, that's a good answer, I guess, but again, it would be a situation where I would read a verse, ask a question that can be answered by looking at that scripture and telling me what it says. The answer was in the verse. But no matter what verse I read, and no matter what question I asked, pray, read the Bible, go to church. Why? They've heard that their whole life. And they were trained to think that way. See, we're not looking at what we think. We're looking at what God's Word says. We get into trouble interpreting the Bible by what we think. Amen? And not allowing the Word of God to interpret itself. Hallelujah. Everybody's in time so far. So the same way that us and we is mentioned so much, there's another little phrase that's mentioned numerous times. In Him. In Christ. we, and in him, and in Christ. So without going into reading each verse, it becomes very obvious as we look at the scriptures that us is those who are in Christ. The we is those who are in Christ. So this book of Ephesians here, what it's really telling us and what it's revealing to us is talking to the people who are in Christ. It's talking to the people who are in him. It's talking to the people who are in Christ. And that means the church.
Amen.
You see, as we dig into the book of Ephesians, one of the things that disturbed me is the destiny of the church. You see, if I walked around, I don't want to get too far ahead of myself. If I walked around today and asked everybody that simple question, please don't answer, this is a rhetorical question, that means that you don't answer me, right? So I don't want you brainstorming on it. But if I asked everybody here, what's the destiny of the church? It would be curious what the answers would be. You know what? God has eternal purposes for the church. And God has a destiny for the church. And in this sense, I'm not just talking about River of Life, the work piece of it. I'm talking about the body of Christ as a whole. I'm talking about everybody on this planet who's in Christ right now. Everybody on this planet who is in Christ, the book of Ephesians is dealing with their purpose, their call, and their destiny. Like I said, if we get into this, you're going to find there's a lot more prophetic things in the book of Ephesians than you would ever imagine, dealing with the destiny of the church.
Amen.
Beloved, we are a people who have a call upon our life. We are a people who have a destiny.
Amen.
We are a people who have God has called out with an eternal purpose to do something. And so it's addressing all of those who are in him, all of those who are in Christ, and nobody else. That's important to understand when we study the book of Ephesians. It's talking about all of those who are in him. It's talking about all of those who are in Christ. In other words, all of those who are born again, the book of Ephesians is dealing with them, who have been baptized into the church, and it's not addressing it to anybody else. So if somebody's not born again, the book of Ephesians is not to them. This is not a letter written to a non-believer. It's not a letter written about a non-believer. You see, when people get into troubles, we interpret some of these verses and say, apply it places where it shouldn't be applied. And two things that it shouldn't be applied. Amen? Let's go back to Ephesians chapter 3. In him, in Christ, let's look at some things here. Where we're really going to begin, verse 3 and 4. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who hath blessed us with all spiritual blessings, and where? In heavenly places. It's no coincidence we heard that this morning, is it? In Christ. Blessed us who are in Christ. Blessed us who are in Christ. Blessed us who are in Christ with all spiritual blessings, correct? Now, I'm going to give you a couple of illustrations this morning that it's very important for you to understand and grasp, or again, you're not going to be able to understand a lot of the book of Ephesians. Now, I'm going to give you an illustration that I've used before, and if you might remember it, and it deals with a ship. Because the book of Ephesians gets into talking about the eternal purposes of God. Now, let me ask you a question. Again, this is a rhetorical question, just to get us to focus on something. How did we get to be in him? How did we get to be in Christ? How did that take place? That's a very serious question. Did we not choose to place faith in the death, burial, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ? As a result of that, we are in him, right? So, what happened somewhere along the line? You heard the gospel. The Holy Spirit drew you. You responded, correct? To the drawing of the Holy Spirit and place your faith in Jesus Christ, death, burial, and resurrection. Right? Let's say that again. Listen very closely. Somebody presented the gospel to you, didn't they? Some way, shape, or form, you heard the gospel, read the gospel, whatever. You might have heard it in church, you might have heard it on the street corner, you might have read the Bible, you might have seen it on TV, you heard it, you might have heard it on the radio. You had heard the gospel in life. And the Lord used that presentation of the gospel, and the Holy Spirit correct? And at that point in time, you were in Him. You were in Christ. You were baptized into the church. Everybody looks at me funny. We'll get into that scripture. So you got that so far? So let me give you an illustration. Because we're going to get into words here that's going to throw people if they don't understand how to look at this. Things like God chose us. Things like predestination. Are words that people have greatly misinterpreted and came to conclusions that aren't true biblically. Imagine there's a ship out here. Oh, wait, I didn't get too far ahead of this. Slow down, Mike. Can you handle two examples in a row? First of all, Ephesians 1:3 says that God hath blessed us with all spiritual blessings, right? Okay, Andy, come here. I want you to be Jesus. Can I be a little chair? Jesus. All right. I'm not going to use this as a message. All right, Andy.
Yeah.
Stand over there. You're Jesus. This is Jesus' care, y'all. You got to use your imagination for a minute. Okay? Now, I've got a thought. The Bible says that Jesus was slain before the foundation of the world, doesn't it? Revelation chapter 13, verse 8 says that. Okay, so stand behind your vessel there, Andy Jesus. Okay, now, so then we have, before the foundation of the world, in the mind, in the heart, and the understanding of the Father through His foreknowledge, looks down through the ages, and has a plan and a purpose and a design that Jesus is going to go to the earth. He's going to die. He's going to be buried. He's going to be resurrected. He's going to ascend back to the right hand of the Father. There's going to be a vessel at that point in time called the church. Going to go all the world. Going to preach the gospel. Men and women of their own free will are going to choose to respond to the gospel and be in Him. Right? Be in Christ. So I got a plan. I'm going to bless those people with all spiritual blessings who are in Him. Okay? So now I've got all these blessings. This is a blessing. This is a healing. This is a financial blessing. We got all these different blessings. This is a couple doses of the Holy Spirit. And we got all these different things and all these different blessings. Here's an understanding of God's Word. Right? Everything you imagine, and throughout all the ages, I begin to pour upon Him all the blessings that could ever be obtained by anybody throughout all of eternity, and I present Him to my Son. He's not my Son at that point in time, technically. Hallelujah. Well, I took a deep breath on the subject for you. So I have all the blessings that I could ever bestow upon anybody, and I give them to Jesus forever. Now, throughout all of eternity, everybody who hears the gospel at that point in time, everybody who the Holy Spirit draws, Holy Spirit pursues their heart, they have their own free will, choose at that point in time to receive Jesus Christ, and they are in Christ, everything there is mine just as much as it's His. Yes. Join Him with Christ Jesus, and I walk on the way. I'm in Christ. Right? Everything that's His is mine. I've been joined in with Christ Jesus, and before the foundation of the world, all spiritual blessings were given unto Him. So I'm in Christ, so they're mine. They belong to me. I'm in Christ, right? I, by my free will, keep in mind here, listen to me. I, by my own free will, made a choice to be in Christ. So they stop, Andy. And every blessing that was predestined and foreordained to belong to me is already there. But I, of my own free will, chose to be in Christ and receive the blessings. It wasn't foreordained that I'd be saved. That was my free will and my choice. What was foreordained and predestined is what would be mine and what I would receive when I made that choice.
Absolutely.
Right?
Yeah. Yes.
Okay.
of God. And people greatly misunderstand these things. The other analogy is a ship. Don't want to confuse you with too many examples. There's a ship. And we walk past the ship, and we all pass over the ship, and over the door of this ship is a scripture. And that scripture says, whosoever will call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved.
Oh, that's probably.
Whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. That's what it says over the door of this ship, right? Whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved, correct? You with me so far?